Hello students, let us start our session of chapter 14, Semiconductor Electronics, Materials, Devices and Simple Circuits. Here, we are defining the flow of free electrons within the material itself. Now, this flow of electrons we are going to control by applying external field or high temperature. So here, this is a basic fundamental thing that how we can control the current, that is important thing for electronic circuits. Initially before, this semiconductor devices has been developed. Before that, vacuum tubes are going to utilize. These vacuum tubes within which electrons are supplied by the heating element from the cathode, these electrons will travel from the generated vacuum in the tube, and with that vacuum, the flow of electrons can be controlled by varying the input voltage at cathode grid. And those electrons now attracted towards other end of the tube, towards the anode. So flow of electron is only in one direction, from cathode to anode. That's why those devices are also known as valves. Here, vacuum is necessary to travel those electrons from the tube, because of those energy can be maintained. Otherwise, the electron can lose their energy by diverting in different paths. Here, using this vacuum tubes, the device can be designed, that is a vacuum diode. Diode, it means two electrodes. So the diode, vacuum diodes, which is having two electrodes, cathode and anode. From the cathode grid, electrons will be generated, and by traveling through the vacuum, it will be attracted towards an anode terminal. Other devices can be triode, means three electrodes, cathode, plate and grid. Tetrode, having four electrodes, and pentode having five electrodes. In general, we are using the devices having two terminals or three terminals, which are widely used. This vacuum tube devices are generally bulky, heavy in weight, heavy in size. It consumes more power to operate, around 100 volt, and having their limited life duration and low reliability. Because of that, we are shifting towards a solid state devices. Solid state devices in which we are using semiconductor matter, through which flow of charge carriers, electrons, can be controlled easily. Here, no external any heating element is required. Normal low external voltage is required to control this flow of charge carriers. These devices are small in size, consumes low power, operate with the low voltage, having longer life and higher reliability. So whatever the disadvantages, we have focused the devices designed using vacuum tubes, which are overcome over here. For example, in earlier days, we have in television, we are having cathode ray tube in television and computer monitors. So this cathode ray tube is working on the principle of vacuum tube. Nowadays, it is replaced by LCD, liquid crystal display monitors, and again these LEDs are replaced by LEDs, that is light emitting diodes. So in this solid state material, we are choosing semiconductor materials only. So why we are choosing semiconductor material to form the electronic devices? For that, first of all, we need to compare all these three materials. So here, let us go through the classification of metals, conductors and semiconductors. This classification can be defined based on their conductivity or resistivity, based on the number of valence electrons in its atomic structure and based on their energy levels. So let us understand those different methods to differentiate all these three materials. First is on the basis of conductivity or resistivity. Resistivity, that is a reciprocal of the conductivity or vice versa. Metals are the material having very low resistivity, so it required very less input and it will form very larger current. That generated response or the current is very much higher at the low input, so we cannot control it easily. So here, for that, the generally the range of resistivity is 10⁻²⁻¹⁸ ohm into meter. So reciprocal of it, the conductivity is having 10⁻²⁸ siemens per meter. If we focus for the insulator, then insulator requires a very larger amount of input to generate even few ampere current. So here we require very higher input and the response is output is very much less. It offers a very higher resistivity in terms of 10⁻¹⁹ to 10⁻¹⁹ ohm into meter. Reciprocal of it, the conductivity is we are having 10⁻¹⁹ to 10⁻¹⁹ siemens per meter. But while we focus about the semiconductors, then semiconductors having the resistivity lesser than insulator and higher than metals. It means few amount of input, low voltage, if we are giving as input, then sufficient amount of current can be driven through that particular device, and that generated current can be linearly controlled by the input, and that offer the resistivity in both the form, in the power of negative to positive. So in both the range it can be controllable. So its resistivity is 10⁻⁵ to 10⁻⁶ ohm into meter, and conductivity is reciprocal to if 10⁻⁵ to 10⁻⁶ siemens per meter. So by this comparison, we can see that semiconductor material having a moderate resistivity or conductivity and whose generated current can be nicely controlled by the input. So from this comparison, we can choose semiconductor, we can justify like this. Here, a range of the semiconductor materials are available, just like elemental semiconductors, silicon and germanium, and widely used material is silicon compared to germanium. Another semiconductors are compound. First, in that we can use inorganic material. Number of examples are there: cadmium sulfide, gallium arsenide, indium phosphide. This cadmium and sulfide, if these two individual materials we are taking, these both are don't have the property of semiconductor. But while we combine both the material inorganically, then their property, their response can be like a semiconductor. Likewise, two different materials, if we combine together for these examples, and if they give the result like a semiconductor, can be utilized as a semiconductor material. This inorganic semiconductor material are utilized to drive the device at high voltage and high power. Another one is the organic material, that is anthracene, doppler, phthalocyanin. Organic polymers are there, that is a polypyrrole, polynylen, polythiophene. Currently used materials are elemental semiconductors, silicon or germanium, and compound inorganic semiconductors. These both semiconductors are utilized widely, but organic and organic polymer materials are utilizing for polymer electronics and molecular electronics. Now, next we can define that how These materials can be classified based on the energy levels. Here, each electron is having certain energy level, and this electron is revolving around the nucleus in its orbital path. This energy levels can never be constant with certain value, but this is varying with some range. This energy levels within which the variation of the energy takes place, which is known as energy band. The electrons which are traveling in last orbital path, which is known as a valence orbit, those electrons are known as valence electrons. And energy level variation of those valence electrons are known as valence band. While after applying external field, these valence electrons can be attracted easily because they are comparatively loosely bounded towards the nucleus. So valence electrons can be affected more through the externally given supply. So while they leave from the valence band and becomes free, so they are now in the conduction band. So this energy variation out of the valence band, that is known above the valence band, that is known as conduction band. For example, here the atomic structure is available for silicon and germanium. Silicon is having 14 atomic number and germanium is having 32 atomic number. So here we are having the phenomena to arrange all the electrons in a particular orbital path by the 2n2 equation. N defines the orbit number. So with that equation, number of electrons occupy that specific orbital number. For example, 2n2 in which n equal to 1. So in first orbital path, 2 electrons can occupy. Likewise, n equal to 2. So using the equation 2n2, in second orbit, 8 electrons can occupy. Likewise, in third orbit, 18 electrons can occupy. So accordingly, as the number of electrons are there, using this equation, number of electrons will arrange in a particular orbital path. Here, for the semiconductor material, in last orbital path, only 4 electrons are there. In any atomic structure, final orbital path in which maximum electrons can be possible, these are 8. So maximum 8 electrons can occupy its last outer orbit path. So here in silicon and germanium, 4 valence electrons are there. It means the atomic structure in which 4 valence electrons are there, known as a semiconductor. So if less than that, either 1 or 2 or 3 valence electrons are there, then those materials are known as metals. And more than 4 valence electrons are there, just like 5, 6, 7 and 8, those materials are known as insulator. So this is how, based on the number of valence electrons, we can classify the material. So here, in valence orbital path, 4 valence electrons are there in the varying 8n energy state. So here, 4n states of energy level that should be in the valence band in semiconductor material, it is splitted in 2 separate parts. 4n states are occupied by the valence electron in valence band at room temperature, and remaining 4n energy states are available in the conduction band, which is empty at absolute zero temperature. So here These total energies are equally divided in two parts, 4 and filled states in valence band and 4 and empty states in conduction band. These two bands are separated by the energy difference, that is a gap available between top level of valence band and bottom level of conduction band is known as energy band gap. So this is how, based on the energy level, this variation can be defined. How this energy level can be utilized? So as you can see in the diagram, in diagram A, conduction band, the bottom level of conduction band and upper level of valence band, both are very near to each other. So by this observation, we can define that energy gap between valence band and conduction band is less. It defines that valence electrons require very less energy to move from valence orbit path and to become a free. In second case, it defines that conduction band and valence band, some of the energy levels are overlapping. So here energy band gap is about to zero. So initially free electrons are already there to conduct the current. This energy band diagram defines for the metals. Now here the diagram B, you can observe over here valence band EV, upper level of valence band EV and lower level of conduction band EC, in between that larger energy gap is there, that is greater than 3 electro volt. It defines that over here to move the electrons from valence orbit path to become a free, it require extra larger amount of external electric field. That's why this energy band diagram predicted for the insulator. And in diagram C, you can see that the energy gap between valence band and conduction band is moderate, that is lesser than insulator and greater than metals. So here, based on this energy band diagram, we can also classify all the materials, either they are metals, conductors or semiconductors. So I hope you understood. Here we are going to end this session. Hope you understood. Thank you.